deep in the deepest ocean, high in the highest mountain. Deep in the deepest ocean, high in the highest mountain. In the forest, in the desert, you can see God's creation. In the forest, in the desert, you can see God's creation.
Allahumma laka alhamd, anta nuru samawati wal ardi wa man fihin. Wa laka alhamd, anta qayyumu samawati wal ardi wa man fihin. Wa laka alhamd, أنت ملك السماوات والأرض ومن فيهن ولك الحمد أنت الحق وقولك حق ووعدك حق ولقاؤك حق والجنة حق والنار حق والساعة حق والنبيون حق ومحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم حق اللهم لك أسلمنا وعليك توكلنا وبك آمنا وإليك أنبنا وبك خاصمنا وإليك حاكمنا فاغفر لنا ما قدمنا وما أخرنا وما أسررنا وما أعلنا وما أنت أعلم به منا أنت المقدم وأنت المؤخر لا إله إلا أنت اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm your host, Karim Abu Zaid, and this is your life broadcasted show, Aqeedah Matters. This is episode number 25. Imagine we already, subhanallah, 25 episodes already. And we're still starting. Today, inshallah, we are talking about the second source of our belief system, which is the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And we are still talking about it. We already spoke about it in the previous three episodes, and this is our fourth episode. So this is like part four already from the second source of our belief system. Very quickly, I'm not going to take a lot of time in recapping because this is the last episode before Ramadan, and we will give you a break throughout the month of Ramadan, inshallah, and we will resume, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, after Ramadan, our show, Aqeedah Matters, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Brief. Our belief system has two fundamental sources. The rest are really built on them, the Quran and the Sunnah. With the Quran and the Sunnah comes in the consensus of the learned scholars, especially from amongst the first three brave generations. They do normally have a consensus over certain issues, but normally 99% of the times, the ijma', the consensus would be based upon an evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah. So we go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. We do have some secondary sources. And the difference between the primary or fundamental sources and the secondary sources, the primary fundamental sources, they stand on their own. Like I can take an evidence from the Quran and already derive a ruling or already derive aqeedah matter from it without the need for a supporting evidence from another source. This is not the case once it comes to the secondary sources. And what are these secondary sources? Two, the sound, uncorrupted natural state, we call it fitrah, or inclination, as long as that fitra still uncorrupted, and the sound aql, the sound intellect. If you have a fitra that is still close to the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created it, and if you do have a sound aql, normally those two do not stand as sources of the belief system or as sources of the religion, but they do conform, they do condone, they do simply affirm what were mentioned in the primary sources, which is the Quran and the Sunnah. Add to this, with the sound aql, with the uncorrupted natural state, we don't normally get the details of the belief system. Rather, we end up with general aspects. The fact that this world cannot be created by itself. Just by using the aql, the sound intellect, certainly that world has to be created by someone. Now, this one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why were we created? I mean, you can ask that question with your intellect to worship. With your intellect, you can already produce the idea that there is a need for a messenger. So those are the overall sources of our belief system, the primary and the secondary. Now, we started presenting to you the first primary fundamental source, which is the Quran, and we spent three episodes. And this is the fourth episode talking about the second source. And I mentioned and I stressed why are we focusing on the Sunnah in particular? Because quite frankly, the systematic attacks against Islam and against the Muslims in order to instill doubts in the hearts, minds, souls of Muslims regarding their religion focused on the arena of the Sunnah. Why? Because those who are planning these attacks, those who do have agendas behind these attacks, they learned that Muslims do have a certain commitment to the Quran. You can't attack them in that area. So now the way to attack Islam and Muslims, attack the tenets of the religion, the central ones, is to attack the Sunnah. And they succeeded to the extent that we ended up with people who say La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, and they are Muslims, but yet when you tell them Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they don't like it. That's not important, it's unnecessary. We only follow the Quran and so forth. So they succeeded, and that is why I think a good service that you do to the religion of Islam, if you understand the Sunnah and how the Sunnah is a source of the religion and how the Sunnah is or how the Sunnah has an authority. In the previous two episodes, we mentioned why a lot of Muslims concluded the motion or the fact that the Sunnah is irrelevant, and in brief again, they adopted the definition of the jurist to the Sunnah. We said that we do have different fields in Islam. There are those who specialize in the area of the belief system, the area of Aqeedah. There are those who specialize in the area of the Hadith. There are those who specialize in the area of Tafsir. There are those who specialize in the area of Usul al-Fiqh, the Islamic legal theory. There are those who specialize in the area of the area of Fiqh, jurists, Fuqaha, a famous word, he's a Mufti, meaning you call him and you ask him the legal value of certain action, of certain sayings, and he tells you it's mandatory, it's recommended, it's permissible, it's haram. Now, one of the words which the jurists use for word recommended, they sometimes say it's mandub, it's mustahab, it's recommended. Sometimes they say it's a sunnah. Now, recommended, you don't have to do it. You get rewarded if you do it, but you're not a sinner if you do not do it. Now, a lot of the Muslims thought now anything that comes from the Sunnah, comes from the Hadith, is all recommended. But they forgot that this is only the definition of the jurist. But if you look into the definition of the scholars of the belief system, they look at the Sunnah, at the Hadith, being a source, a primary source of the religion, and also being an authoritative, or it has an authority, a legal authority. The fact that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said something, that means it has to be implemented. So we figured out why, because we want to help our brothers. Listen, a lot of these brothers, they are very good-hearted, and I met a lot of them and throughout my career as an imam in the United States. These brothers, normally they speak like this, really out of being unaware. Now, by educating them, they normally come back to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and they do recognize its authenticity, and they do recognize its authority, and they begin actually implementing it in a way. Last episode, again I'm still recapping, last episode we asked that question, was the Sunnah preserved? Like the Quran. When we spoke about the Quran, we said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala vowed, Inna nahnu nazzalna al-dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. Surah Al-Hijr. Indeed, we have brought down the dhikr, the reminder, and indeed we will guard it, we will preserve it. Now, the question here, was the Sunnah included in that vow or not? Now, to answer that question, and this is how we introduced the subject last episode, there is another question that needs to be that we need to ask and we need to answer. The question was, is the Sunnah wahy, a revelation like the Quran? Because if the Sunnah a revelation like the Quran, that means that vow included the Sunnah. That means the Sunnah has to be preserved. But if the Sunnah was not a revelation, then it's irrelevant. The discussion really is irrelevant. So now we answer that question, and we said that the Sunnah is a revelation like the Quran exactly. So the Sunnah is a revelation like the Quran exactly. And we furnished a lot of evidence in a way to you. There is one more evidence that I wish to share with you, which is very interesting, and you're probably noticing that I'm smiling because, subhanAllah, as if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam existed at this time, but yet it was not there. The hadith fi sunan al-imam al-tirmidhi and musnad Ahmad, hadith al-miqdad ibn Ma'di Yakrib, or ibn Ma'di Karb, one of two ways to say it. What the messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. Indeed, I was given the Qur'an and something like it along with it. Something like the Qur'an. Along with the Qur'an. Imagine. Something like the Qur'an along with the Qur'an. Here's why I'm smiling. But soon will be the time when a man who will be reclining on his couch with a full stomach, full belly, and he will say the following, we should only follow the Quran, no sunnah. ما وجدنا فيه من حلال حللنا وما وجدنا فيه من حرام حرمنا. By the way, look at the description. A man with a full stomach, a full belly, reclining on his couch, meaning he does not want to work. He does not want to implement Islam. You see, the Sunnah gets us working. The Sunnah gets us working. I mean, listen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded. I mean, just to give you an example, that these brothers who only follow the Quran, the likeness of that person, they actually believe that Muslims have to pray only three times. Seriously, if you're only going to follow the Quran, this is the only way. Oh, why? أقم الصلاة طرفي النهار وزلفا من الليل. So the mandatory salah is طرفي النهار, that means Fajr, Maghrib, and there is a salah at night called Zulaf, Salat al-Zulaf. That's the, because they are following the Quran. You see, they are not aware that the Quran directed us to go to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to learn from him how many salahs and what time each salah should be observed and how should we pray each salah. ولذلك عمران بن حسين والحديث في المسند الحسن البصري نريد ذات حديث ذات عمران بن حسين أبا نجيد عمران بن حسين I'm sorry he was narrating the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to a group of the predecessors. And one of them stood up and he said, Hadithna bil Quran. Why are you talking to us about the Sunnah? Why don't you tell us the Quran? Then he looked at him, you and your friends recite the Quran. Tell me, how do you figure out the number of salahs in the Quran? How should you pray each salah? What time for each salah? Tell me, huh? Where? You and your friends recite the Quran. Where do you find the zakah 2.5% and so forth? Subhanallah. So the point I'm trying to make is that the sunnah, look at the accurate description of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to this character. He is reclining in his sofa, meaning he's relaxing. He's happy with this world, and he has a full stomach, a full belly. No offense to anybody who has that, but this is somebody who is what? Who is more interested in this world. Now the sunnah gets you working. Now he wants to only follow the Quran. But the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam made it crystal clear. Indeed, whatever the Messenger of Allah forbids is what Allah forbids. Indeed, whatever the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam commands is what Allah commands. من يطع الرسول فقد أطاع الله. Whoever obeys the Messenger has indeed consequently obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, this evidence was necessary just to show you that the harakat al-Qur'aniyin, the movement of al-Qur'aniyin, and by the way, we say Qur'aniyin majazan. I'm using the word Qur'aniyin just to identify them, but in reality, they don't follow the Qur'an because the Qur'an commands you to follow the Sunnah. Now, if you do not follow the Sunnah, are you a follower of the Quran? No. Like exactly the Jews and the Christians. The Jews and the Christians do have commands to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So their books commanding them to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, their messengers gave them the glad tiding of the coming wa mubashiran bi rasulin yati min ba'd ismuhu Ahmad, giving you the glad tiding of a messenger who come after me whose name is Ahmad. Now follow him. Now, the fact that you're not following the Quran and you're not following the final messenger, are you following your Torah then? Are you following your gospel then, Injil then? You're not. You're actually disobeying them. Likewise, we're using the word al-Quraniyin just majazan, just to identify those people to you. One last thing before we go into how the Sunnah was preserved, I want to say that this was the understanding of the righteous predecessors, Salaf. They understood that the Quran is a revelation. I'm sorry, the Sunnah of Rasulullah, the Hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a revelation. I mentioned the story which Imam al-Nasa'i rahimahullah compiled in his Sunan, the story between Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and Abu Barz al-Aslami. Last episode, but let's just mention it one more time. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu was during his reign, being the successor of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was sitting and somebody came to his place and he upsetted Abu Bakr al-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He made him upset. Abu Barz al-Aslami was present at the time and he said, Ya Khalifata Rasulillah, O successor of the Messenger of Allah, command me, I'll kill him. Command me, I'll kill him. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq turned away from him and he disappeared. Abu Barza went home. Abu Bakr sent for him to come at night. فَقَالَ لَهُ He said to him, Ya Abu Barza, were you serious? Were you serious when you told me that? That you're actually going to kill the man if I would command you to do that? So He said, هذه لم تكن لأحد إلا لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. This only exclusive to the messenger of Allah. What does he mean? That a judge would rule a ruling when he is angry. ولذلك الإمام النسائي mentioned something, لا يقضي القاضي وهو غضبان. The judge should not rule when he is angry. The only one who can rule when he is angry is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why? وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى. He does not speak out of desire. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. It's a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And hadith Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As and the Muslim and others, Sunan Abi Dawood, when he used to record everything which the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, the chiefs of Quraysh said to him, Ya Abdullah, don't write everything that the messenger says. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a human being. He speaks when he's angry and he speaks when he's happy and he has his own affairs. So Abdullah radiallahu stopped recording the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Guess what? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam noticed that. Another wording, Abdullah recorded that to him. That the people of Quraysh, the chiefs of Quraysh, banned me from doing this, told me to stop doing that because you speak when you are... Look, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke in a very serious tone and he said, Uktub, write it down. وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي, نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدِ وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ By the one in whose hand my soul is, لَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهُ إِلَّا حَقَّ Everything that comes out of this mouth, he did like this, from between these lips is the truth. Whether I'm angry, whether I'm upset, because he is guarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We also read the statement of Umar ibn al-Khattab in more than one occasion. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh said this statement in the pulpit. What did he say? O people, the opinion of Allah his messenger, the opinions, plural, of Allah his messengers were correct only because Allah would reveal them to him. As for our opinions, me and you, they are nothing but thoughts and conjecture. See? Because it's a revelation. So when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam expresses his opinion regarding a matter, it's a revelation. And listen, if he was not given sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the go ahead to initiate that opinion, guess what? Jibreel alayhi salam would come down and tell him, no, don't do it this way, do it this way. Important to know so. A predecessor whose name is Hassan ibn Atiyah, and the author was recorded in Majmu' al-Fatawi al-Shaykh al-Islam. You know what he said? Jibreel alayhi salam used to come down to the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam with the sunnah as he used to come to him bringing the Quran as well. So this is a statement. So this is the understanding of our righteous predecessor. So we're not like coming 1430 years later trying to say, we're not discovering that. We're just reteaching that. We're educating you about what has been already established. But unfortunately, a lot of us were stripped out from that knowledge. And that is why we ended up being nourished by other views, cultural practices, societal norms that veiled our fitrah to accept the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now, all what I said is wonderful. With that, you can address Muslims, believers. But if you want to talk to an Orientalist, mustashriq, someone whose job is to attack your religion, now you want to prove to him using logical explanations how the sunnah was preserved, how it was preserved. This is something that we have to discuss. You see, whatever I said is to Muslims, to believers. And I'm 100% positive that a lot of those who had a different view upon hearing that, not just it's because of me, because it's the truth. And it's whatever we say is by evidence, is backed by evidence. We're not saying. Now, the question here is, the sunnah is a revelation. Here is the verdict. The Sunnah is a revelation like the Quran. Therefore, it has to be preserved like the Quran. Now, what are the means which were used to preserve the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? This is what we need to discuss after a short break. So, right now, we're trying to furnish the means, the steps. Like when we spoke about the Quran was preserved because of that. How it was preserved, Rasulullah ﷺ would receive it, and then he would ask the scribes to write it, then he would ask them to read it back to him, then he would rectify if there is a mistake, then after that it was recorded in writing, given practical steps. Likewise, the Sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used our righteous predecessors, used the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, used the predecessor, the followers, the tabi'een, to preserve the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let me take a short break and come back and start discussing these steps, these means which were used to preserve the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and take your phone calls as well, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Don't go away. Assalamu alaikum ورحمة الله وبركاته.
In the forest, in the desert, you can see God's creation.
If I think I lost my ablution, but I'm not sure, do I have to make wudu again? Is it allowed for Muslims to visit the graveyard, or is that shirk? Am I allowed to say Jumma Mubarak to someone? Can I get to know a sister before marriage? I have so many questions, and I feel that I've just reached a dead end. If only I could find someone trustworthy to answer my questions. Someone who speaks based on proof from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet.
Imagine that the Anbiya, they were the ones, they were the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they had the hardest task.
He assumed that he had some kind of superiority, and he was a better, more chosen, you know, a select, better person because he had this wealth. And then you look at all the other people who had wealth, and some of them were the worst people. You had Fir'aun and Harun.
Reviving your niyyah time and again, that you're doing insincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Most of the youth, they think, oh, I'm going to pray when I'm old, it's okay, and I'll have fun in my life. Later on, I'll work, I'll grow my beard, I'll pray 5 times a day. And all these things, they think that that's later on in their life, and they don't know when they will die.
Amira, who's your role model?
Khadija radiallahu anha.
And why?
Because she was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wife, and she was the first lady to believe in Islam.
In the forest, in the desert, you can see God's creation.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, dear viewers. Aqeedah Matters here. First of all, the email address, aqeedahmatters@hoda.tv, should be shown on the screen. We also do have a Facebook page that I'm inviting all of you to go and like. Facebook.com/Aqeedah Matters. Alhamdulillah, my last call to you did produce almost 100 plus likes. So I'm hoping that some more can go and join the Facebook page, Aqeedah Matters. So far, we have almost 1,100 and plus participants. I want to warn you also that we do post all these shows on YouTube format in that Facebook page. So if you happen to miss any of these episodes, certainly you can go back and watch it. Because, like I said, we were following a certain method of presenting the matters of Aqeedah to you, and we're building up. So sometimes if you miss a certain episode, you may find yourself out of the loop. So the way to fix that is to go back and watch these shows on YouTube, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Finally, I would like to hear from you. Phone numbers are shown on the screen. You can go ahead and give us a call, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But as I wait anxiously for your phone calls, let's talk to Orientalists, people who are not Muslims to begin with, or people who are still skeptical. They are Muslims and they are still skeptical even after the presentation which I had before the show. Tell me the means which the companions, first of all, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the companions and their students used to preserve the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first thing, and this is the statement of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to speak. Okay, I do have a phone call. Let me take that phone call and we will carry on. Brother Assam from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa barakatuh. Thank you very much for the show. I enjoy it very much. Sheikh Karim, I greet you and all the teamwork. Please, I suggest, it's a mis-suggestion, to translate the book of Ma'arij of Kabul into English by a good wealthy man. And I gently ask you to supervise this project because of the importance of this book, and because he explains the belief system in a very simple way. As you said, Prophet Muhammad told the companions, the Sahaba, the belief system, then he told them the Quran. And thank you very much.
Jazakallah khair. Brother Assam is our regular viewer. Mashallah, he is very regular, keeping up with the show. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him. Yes, Ma'arij al-Qubul is a masterpiece in the field of Aqeedah. And inshallah, I would love to, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, look into it. But it's a masterpiece. But to my knowledge, it has not been translated yet. So hopefully there is somebody who is watching and can maybe take the initiative and start translating that beautiful book. I will certainly look into it, inshallah, Brother Assam. Jazakallah khair. So we go back to the way that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to deliver his speech. Anas says that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to speak in a very slow manner. To the extent, لو أراد العاد أن يعد كلامه لأعد, that if the listener wants to count how many words did he say, he would have been able to do so. Also, Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم, most of the time, he would repeat the statement three times. Three times, and in a very slow motion. Now, he encouraged, the second thing, he encouraged the companions, his Sahaba, to learn, memorize, understand, for convey his statements, his Sunnah. And we do have a lot of evidence for that. نضر الله امرأً, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brighten, illuminate the face of someone. سمع مقالتي, who hears what I said, فحفظها, then he memorized, فوعاها, then he understood it, فحفظها. Then he memorized it. Then he conveyed it the way that he heard it. Imagine a statement like this to be made to the Sahaba. Imagine what would they do. So he said, not only to hear it, rather learn it, rather memorize it, understand it, then convey it. And that is why, subhanAllah, you would find a lot of the Sahaba would actually use that statement when they would narrate the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You know what they would use to say? What they would say? سَمِعَتْهُ أُذُنَاي وَوَعَاهُ قَلْبِي. Listen, this hadith which I'm narrating to you right now, my ears heard it and my heart comprehended it, understood it. Assalamu alaikum. I do have a phone call. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Abu Abdul Rahman from Jordan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi, Sheikh. Barakallahu feek.
Feekum barak.
For the sake of Allah, Sheikh. Barakallahu feek. And thank you for your amazing episodes, Aqeedah Matter. I want to share barakallahu feek about the so-called Quran. Yeah. Even the Quran is against them. If you read the ayat which talk about the prayer, salawat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Aqim al-salata, Duluk al-shamsi ila ghasaq al-layl. Duluk al-shams, in Arabic, Duluk, teen, zawal, time of zawal, till the time of Maghrib. Yani it means dhuhr, asr, and Maghrib. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Duluk al-shamsi ila ghasaq al-layl. Al-ghasaq, you know, Sheikh Ibn Asmina said, like, ghasaq, huwa al-malam, the darkness. It means the darkness of night. So it means Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. Wa Quran and Fajr, it's Fajr prayer. No Quran against them. But there was it's prayer here, it means like dua, it's not mean salah. So what about the ayah talks about Salatul Khawf? You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned sujood and qiyam. So what is in sujood? How we have to make this sujood? Even Quran against them, and yani barakallahu
fiqh, jazakallahu khair. Wa fiqh barak, Abu Abdurrahman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for your input, beautifully, eloquently made. May Allah reward you. This is a good addition to what I said. Like I said, the Quran is against them. In general, the Quran commands them to follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once it comes to the application of the summed up commands, like Aqim al-Salah, for example. So for them not to pray the way that the messenger prayed because they reject the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would really disqualify them to be called Qur'aniyin to begin with. And this is what the point that I was trying to make, that the Qur'an is against them. And we're actually using that word describing them to be Qur'aniyin is really majazan, yani is I'm just trying to identify the group, but in reality they are not Quraniyin at all, because if they are Quraniyin, the Quran is against them. Very well made point, brother Abu Abdurrahman. May Allah reward you. Please, jazakallahu khaira. So we were saying that the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, upon hearing that statement, that they would sometimes narrate the hadith, and this is what they would say: سَمِعَتْهُ أُذُنَاي, my ears have heard this, وَوَعَاهُ قَلْبِي. Not only this, subhanAllah, I look at it, sometimes they would actually convey the hadith the same exact manner the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would deliver it. Anas, for example, one day he was riding his camel or his mule, and then he smiled, he laughed, you know, he made a laugh like this, and then he asked them, the students, the people around him. We know Anas radiallahu anhu, when he was a little boy, a little child, his smart mother, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her, Umm Sulaim, brought him And she asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to make dua for Anas. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allahumma barik lahu fi umrihi wa malihi wa waladi. Oh Allah, bless his life, bless his children, bless his wealth. Anas, by the way, lived, some of the accounts, 100 years, 110, 105 variations there, based on the wording. So Anas had the opportunity to convey, of conveying the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look how he used to convey it. One day he was around his students, and he was riding his mule or camel, and then he laughed. And then he looked at them and said, أَلَا تَسْأَلُونِي لِمَاذَا ضَحِكْتْ? Why don't you ask me why I'm laughing? So they asked him, why are you laughing? Why are you smiling? He said, one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was riding his camel and then he smiled. And then he told us, he asked us, how come you don't ask me why I smiled? His identical way to convey the message, to convey the hadith, identical way. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Of course, Anas was there. He heard that. He said, why are you laughing, O Rasulullah? And then he saqa al-hadith, the famous hadith regarding the servant of Allah arguing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding witnesses, accepting only witnesses from himself. Al-shahid, yani, this is the witness in the hadith. That the companion would narrate hadith Imran, the famous hadith regarding the Uthman ibn Affan called upon his mawla, hadith and the Muslim, called upon his mawla Imran, bring me water. Atini bi wadu, water to make wudu. Then he stood up and he made wudu. And then he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made that wudu in front of me. And he said, man tawadda nahwa wudu'i hadha wa saqa al-hadith. So again, this is how they were encouraged to learn, the companions, how they were encouraged to learn the sunnah of Rasulullah. Some of them used to dedicate, look at the hadith in Bukhari, Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, used to have an Ansari neighbor, a neighbor from al-Ansar. Kuntu, he says this, kuntu wajaru li min al-Ansar natanawab. Me and my neighbor from Al-Ansar used to alternate attending the learning circles of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would go one day and spend the whole day with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hearing his hadith, learning his hadith, understanding his hadith, memorizing his hadith, and then coming back at night and letting Umar know what he learned for the day. And the following day, Umar would go and do likewise, so they would end up. Abu Huraira. Look, Abu Huraira. Why especially Abu Huraira? Abu Huraira, for your information, receives the most of the attacks from those who hate the Sunnah. From those who... Why? Because he is top of the list of narrators from the companions. He narrated 5,347 hadith, more or less. Look how he used to do it. How? First of all, at the very beginning, even so, Abu Huraira became a Muslim the last 5 years of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But he was one of those who later on, some of the companions who were with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam throughout time would complain, how come Abu Huraira is narrating too many hadith? He actually made that statement, listen, you've been busy in the markets, but I was around the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam all the time learning the hadith from him. But at the very beginning, he actually complained regarding forgetting, that he would forget. He would hear the hadith from Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then he would forget the hadith. He complained this. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, ibsit rida'ak, extend your garments, made dua for him. He made dua for him. He did like this. And he made dua for him that Abu Huraira would not forget any of my hadith. He said, I have never forgotten any of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But not only the dua of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He seek the means. He said, I used to divide the night into three portions. One third to pray tahajjud, one third to sleep, one third to pray tahajjud, And the last third is to review the memorization of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. A large group, a large number of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left their homes and they moved to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in order to hear the hadith from him. They spent all the time. Another way is the discussions. They used to have mudhakara. They used to discuss the hadith with one another, the companions. So after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would narrate a hadith to them, they would sit with one another as if they are reviewing. What did you hear? Oh, I heard that. This one will say, I heard. No, I heard that. This one, no, I heard that. So they would certainly match one another's memorization or writing of the hadith in order to verify and rectify some of the mistakes. Another tool is practice. You see, the problem with a lot of us, and listen, I'm talking wallahi about me, not just you, that we memorize so many hadith, but we do forget it. Why? Because we never place it into practice. That was different with the Sahaba. They practiced the hadith. You see, kalam al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not just a theory. No, it's a theory and practice. I'm telling you, the best way to memorize the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to apply it. ولذلك, I believe Waqi' ibn al-Jarrah used to tell his students this. Once he would teach them the sunnah, he used to make that statement. Ya ahl al-hadith, addu zakat al-hadith. Oh, people of hadith, pay the zakah for the hadith. Then they would ask him, what do you mean? He said, don't you memorize 100 hadith? Okay, what is the zakah on 100? Just implement 2.5%. Of course, we're supposed to implement more than that. But just implement 2.5%. So the Sahaba, they used to compete in practicing what they learned from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why the Sunnah was a living. Imagine when Abdullah ibn Umar heard that hadith regarding the two qirat, regarding if you pray janazah on a deceased, and if you follow the janazah procession until he is buried. The narrator is Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. You receive two qirat. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, what is two qirat, O Messenger of Allah? He said, a chunk of reward as huge as the terrain of Uhud, the mountain of Uhud. Imagine Abdullah ibn Umar made it, لَقَدْ فَرَّطْنَا فِي قَرَارِيطٍ كَثِيرًا. Ya Allah, I didn't hear about this hadith. You know, we wasted a lot of qararit. From that time on, any janazah, he would follow the janazah. Not just to fulfill a social order here. A lot of us go to the janazah just to participate so that the family of the deceased would recognize you and they would return the favor to you. No, no, no. You're going there sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So practice. Practice was a key. That the sunnah was a living reality in the society. And this is what maintained or kept the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Writing. Another tool is writing. They used to record. Of course, we know that at certain stage, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam banned his companions from writing the hadith. Why? Why? Because he was concerned that the distinction between the Quran and the hadith was not placed. But that ban was not made, was a general ban. But he allowed certain people to still record his hadith. And I shared with you the story of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhuma. Write it down by the one in whose hand my soul is. Anything that comes out of my mouth is the truth. So the ban was for certain people, for a general banning, but later on he allowed it. But even during that general ban, he allowed certain people to write his hadith, and the story of Abdullah ibn Amr was there. Traveling in search of the hadith. Imagine the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to travel, especially after the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They used to travel in order to verify and rectify accounts which they had. I only have a couple of minutes left. Inshallah, here it is. Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam issued two serious warnings. And imagine this. Those two warnings, subhanallah, were like the seed that kept the sunnah of Rasul, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam alive until this very day. The first warning, a famous hadith by the way, and this hadith by the way, mutawatir bitariqa ya'ani, the highest number of companions and predecessors in any hadith is in that hadith. What? من كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. Ya Allah, imagine the importance of this warning. Whosoever attribute a lie against me, says that I said something which is untrue, he will have a seat in the hellfire. Meaning he will last for a while. He will stay there for a while. So this is the first warning. Serious one. Imagine this hadith saved the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and stopped a lot of people who do have the consciousness of Allah from attributing lies against the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The second warning, man katama ilman aljamahu Allah bi lijamin min nadin yawm al-qiyamah. Whoever conceal warning against the concealment of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would bridle that person with a rain out of fire in the day of resurrection. So this is in practicality how the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was preserved during his time and right after his time. Insha'Allah, after Ramadan, we'll go over the era of the followers of the tabi'een when the fitna between the Muslims erupted and the motives for people to start fabricating and forging hadith, and how, subhanallah, the Muslims and the scholars of hadith combated this, and they came up with that science that has never been recognized prior to this, the science of the hadith. Imagine Luke, Mark, and John, all these gospels. There is no chain of narration. Subhanallah, the five books of the Christians, the New Testament. Imagine this. They say that the gospel according to Luke. Where is the chain? Luke came 50, 60 years after the so-called crucifixion. Where is the chain? Tell me, where is the chain? There is no chain. You know, they use something that we scholars of hadith use, sighat al-tamrid, urawiya. It was narrated. You know, when you narrate a hadith like this, come on, I'm not going to accept that hadith. Where is the chain? What do you mean it was narrated? Who narrated it? Inshallah, I will come to this. In the next episode, inshallah, which will be after Ramadan. Brothers and sisters in Islam, in closing, allow me to take less than a minute to congratulate you for the coming of the month of Ramadan. And this is the sunnah. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, kama warad inda at-Tirmidhi, he used to stand up and congratulate his companions. Ataakum shahrun mubarak. So we could say Ramadan mubarak to all of you. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by his beautiful names and lofty attributes, to guide all of us, including me, and including everyone who is watching this, and to observe the best Ramadan ever. That we do fast Ramadan, iman and wahtisaba, so that we can earn the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we're not distracted by the World Cup, by the soap operas, by the TV stations, and we excel in all aspects of righteousness and piety and goodness during that month. Of course, Aqeedah matter will pause throughout the month of Ramadan, but I will have, inshallah, a show called Hasten to Goodness, almost 12 midnight every night after Taraweeh, inshallah. Myself and Brother Malik will be out there every night in Ramadan, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, so you can join me, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But we will resume, inshallah, Aqeedah matters, giving you a chance here to study what we already presented after Ramadan, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. I love you all for the sake of Allah, and I can't wait till I see you after Ramadan in Aqeedah Matters again. Till then, I leave you in the care of Allah. And again, Ramadan Mubarak. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Deep in the deepest ocean, high in the highest mountain, deep in the deepest ocean, high on the highest mountain, in the forest, in the desert, you can see God creation. In the forest, in the desert, you can see God creation. He made us different nation, and there's no differentiation. He made us different nation, and
And there's no differentiation. If you're black, if you're white, we are all God's creation. If you're black, if you're white, we are all God's creation. Deep in the deepest ocean, high on the highest mountain, in the forest, in the desert, you can see God's creation.